Yeah, they put their foot on our necks, but we let them, so what you expect? When the last time you picked up a book? When the last time you wrote your own check? Yeah, we all up on IG and Netflix, and the devil, he got you on chill. He's scrolling and trolling your life, you can't see he destroying, cause he got you still. It's your vision that he wanna steal, and your mission that he wanna kill. No condemning, I'm keeping it real. It's conviction I want you to feel. And I'm praying today that we wake up, and the mess that we made, we can make up. It's because of a skin that they hate us. Don't know what it's gonna take to shake us. Listen. And I'm not pacing, I'm just patient. They thought that I was moving slow, they didn't know I was waiting. Yeah, it's my season, it's my reason. I talk with God every day, I'm not into people pleasing. And forever I'm for God, and I just want you to know without him, life is hard. So get your heart right, get your house in order.
Hi, I'm Charcy Curtis. Some of you may know me as SZA Diva out of Fayetteville, North Carolina. This is the I'm For God Movement podcast, where we allow everyday people to tell their testimonies. Y'all know I like to bring my family on here sometimes, so I got a family member for y'all today, my Auntie Wanda. I'm going to give her a chance to introduce herself so y'all can feel like y'all know her a little better. Can you give them, you know, tell them who you are and all that good stuff?
Thank you so much, Chelsea. I'm Wanda Melvin Tatum, Minister Wanda Melvin Tatum. If some of you would like to have me pray with you at times, you can reach me on my
Email
at wtatum58@icloud.com. And that's if you'd like for me to pray with you.
Okay.
Let me tell you a little bit about Wanda Melvin Tatum.
Okay.
I'm 66 years old. I just had a birthday. As growing up as a child, I am one of six. I was born in a neighborhood where everything was very poor. Mm-hmm. My mom died whenever I was 12 years old, and my father was the one that raised me with him and my sister. To make a long story short, mm-hmm. We were very, very poor. We could lay in our house and look up at the rooftop and see the rain come in. We could look down at the floor and see the chickens from the outside. We were so poor that we didn't have clothes like everyone else had to wear to school. But the good part about it was is that my daddy kept us together as a family. We were taught to share. We were taught to love on one another. We were taught that no matter what we didn't have, we were to accept the bitter with the sweet. The good part about life and what it had to offer us was that my father always taught us that irregardless of what the other person had, don't despise the other person for what you don't have, because one day you'll be able to have the same things that they have. And I'm so glad that on today I can tell somebody else that in spite of it all, God still is showing favor to this day. Okay. I'd like to share a little bit with you today about how life can be if you don't feel as though things are going just great for you. There was a time in my life whenever I had some rough times and I've had some good times. It was really rough for me in the 70s because I have two children and I have a husband that I've had for 46 years. My husband and I had went through a very rough battle and I had lost my children to my husband. I had to go through a bitter divorce, but the divorce never really actually got on the table. But the children was given to my husband instead of being given to me. I had to learn how to calm my own self down in order to be able to get my children back, which was a very hard time in my life. Not only did I have to learn how to get my children back, but I was at a point in my life where I didn't know how to be a real mother. Being a mother meant that I had to step up to the plate and accept responsibility for my own actions. My actions were not that of a mother. I wanted to run the streets, you might would say. I've done some of just about anything you can name except for sell my body and do drugs. But I did a lot of other things that a person wouldn't be pleased of. I have said a lot of things that was not pleasing. I've done a lot of things that was not pleasing. And God was not pleased with my life. He was not pleased with the way I was living my life. So what began to happen in my life was my health began to decline. I've been in the hospital 72 times in my life, and I'm 66 years old. I've had two massive heart attacks. I've had a massive stroke. I've had 19 major operations. I've had over 15 different scenarios where the doctors have come in and said to my family that this really does not look good. We're looking at the size of the story where, you know, one day may not be a good day and then this day may be over. But God was only showing me what he could do with my life. It took me to come to realization with the fact that God was only preparing me for what was to become a better scenario in my life. As time went on, and after all these scenarios began to take place, God had to lay me down and actually show me what he was getting ready to do with my life. After I almost lost my life the very last time, he showed me, I'm going to use you for my glory. Mm-hmm. We have chances, y'all. God gives everybody free will. And in giving us free will, you have choices and chances to give God your life. He offers us redemption at an order of sacrifice that you can come to him, give him your heart, and he will in turn open up his heart to you to receive you mm-hmm. just as you are, and then you make the transition. Mm-hmm. So in doing so, I had to begin to tell myself and to allow God to know that I was ready to read my Bible. I would not read my Bible. I would go day after day. I would not talk about Jesus. I had children, but I would not share anything about Jesus with my children. And you're talking about 45 years old where I didn't want my story told, nothing about what was really and actually going on in my life in all actuality. Mm-hmm. So as time went on and I began to see and understand what God was doing with me and all of these different scenarios began to happen and he was still using me time after time, I saw that things had to change. And then he finally spoke to me and said, you know, Wanda, the very thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take your life. I'm no longer going to allow you to keep running in and out and saying that you're this and saying you're that and continue to play with me. I'm not a source to be played with. There comes a time when you have to stand up and when you say that you're living holy, when you say that you're living righteous, when you say that you believe in me, you got to believe in me wholeheartedly. You cannot continue to just say these things and do these things and you're still lying. I was lying, cheating, stealing, you name it, I was doing it. But God allowed me to know that you cannot continue to do this. Mm-hmm. You have to walk in line. You have to line up with the word. Yeah. And as I began to find out that I had to line up with the word, things began to change in my life. Yes, I did have two massive heart attacks back to back, 6 months apart. Yes, I did survive cancer. Yes, I did have a massive stroke where I lost everything. I lost my sight, my hearing, my speech. I lost it all. I was unable to do anything for myself. I stayed in the hospital 38 days on three different occasions. I had an upper GI bleed where I was in the intensive care unit for 17 days where they had actually counted me out and had called the family in. We don't see where nothing can go on after this day. But I want to tell you that I'm so grateful that God is still handing out blessings because my family got a chance to witness a miracle, y'all, mm-hmm. where the doctors themselves did not believe until this day that after being in the critical care unit and for 17 days and leaving the critical care unit and going home, not step down, but going straight home from the critical care unit, the doctors was like, we have never, ever in the history of ever seen anything like this. Y'all, I was bleeding. If you know anything about excessive blood bleeding, I was bleeding from everywhere. I mean, it was like you've never seen before. And if you don't know anything about that, you can ask your different nurses and doctors How does a person just continuously bleed and just lose so much blood? And they're saying over and over again that we got to come in and give all this blood to this person. And all of a sudden, the doctors come back and said, you know what? We're not going to give any blood. We're not going to do this. You tell me that God is not handing out blessings, that he's not working miracles. If you can see me, you're looking at a miracle that was performed right in front of my family where they could actually see this. And believe me when I tell you, this was something that was meant for me to see, for my family to see, and for me to experience and know that if God was doing all of this for me, mm-hmm. he could do this for anybody else. And there's somebody out there today that needs to know and understand that if God did this for me, he can surely do that for them.
What keeps you grounded?
And what keeps me grounded is the fact that out of all that I've been through, God still has his hands on me. And he's allowing me to know that I haven't taken you away yet. I'm still working on you.
Okay, what is that something that you asked God for and you wish you could have been a little bit more specific about it?
I wish that I would have been more specific when I said to him, God, I just wish that you could just work on me a little bit more and I would have given you more of my attention. More of my attention had been spent on God. Reading my Bible and searching my heart and searching my soul and allowing my children to know that it's him I want. It's him I'm looking for.
Okay. How did you turn your pain into power?
I turned my pain into power by saying, God, it's me, oh Lord. I'm standing in need right now. I'm standing in need of prayer. I'm standing in need of knowing that you can do these things that I'm asking for. Because without you, I am absolutely nothing.
Okay. What would you like people to know about you that they don't know?
That I was what some may say a very mean individual.
Okay. If you could change one thing in your life, what would it be and why?
If I could change one thing about my life, I would tell everybody that it's not about meanness. It don't have to be about you. Okay. Take your focus off you and put your mind on Jesus.
Okay.
Stay rooted and grounded on him. Okay. He is the source.
Okay. What would you say is different about the old you versus the new you?
The old me didn't take the time to hear what anybody else had to say.
Okay.
I was wild. I was just unruly. I mean, mm-hmm. I had no purpose. I was going to and fro and just stumbling all around, mm-hmm. not knowing which way to go. Okay. But I have a purpose now in life.
Okay. What was that moment like when you realized God was real without a shadow of a doubt?
Whenever I saw my life disappearing in front of my face,
okay.
and I knew if I hadn't reached back and said, God, to you I surrender all, mm-hmm. I saw me slipping away.
Okay. What's more important to you, loyalty, love, or respect?
Love.
Okay. What comes first to you, imagination or vision?
I can imagine it, but I need to know that there is still a vision.
Okay. When you, like I said, y'all, this is my family member. So when you first seen me with the brand, I Am For God, what first came to your mind?
When I first saw the brand, I Am For God, I said, Chelsea has outdone herself this time. Because I Am For God is truly I Am For God. Because if you are for God, you can't be for nobody else right. but God.
God is a jealous God.
God is a jealous God.
Yes, he is.
And he says he has no respectable person.
Right.
And if we can just live and learn on that,
mm-hmm.
we can be for God.
Yes. Leave the people with something positive.
Something positive?
Yes,
I would say to them that if you want to know that there's life and life thereafter, keep your mind focused on God. Allow God to be your morning, noon, and night. Don't stray away. No matter how ugly it may look at times, no matter how it may seem as though you get discouraged, it may seem as though you don't understand,
mm-hmm.
it may seem as though you're hurting and nobody's hurting but you,
mm-hmm.
don't take your eye off the prize, and that's God. God is the final source.
Yes,
he knows and sees everything, looking well beyond our fault. But recognizing all of our needs.
Yes, he is.
It's all about God.
Yes, I thank you for coming today. And I thank y'all for tuning in. Like I said, you just never know who I'm going to have on here. And like I said, I love you, but God loves you more. Until next time.